everybody, and welcome to Align with Zion. A very special day today. We are sitting at the Haas Promenade that is basically overlooking the whole of the Old City and the City of David. So you can have a beautiful view of the way that it was also in the ancient days. And today with me is Shaul Kullook. And you guys will know a little bit, those who have been following us on the blogs and also some of the articles in Breaking Israel News will know some of the work that we have covered with Shaul. But today is very important because we are in August, and some of the calculations that Shaul is working on is very specific to where we are right now. And that's why I felt that it is important for us to share that with you. Now, you guys know how I feel about conspiracy theories and predictions and all those kind of things, and that we should try to steer clear of that. These calculations, however, have empirical proof of certain historical events, but also to some of the events that will happen soon. And that's why I feel it important to share that with you. And then we will test it and we will see if it's important to keep on following these things. If so, it's important for us to share it with you today. So, firstly, you also know that I spoke a lot about the temple itself, the measurements of the temple, how every measurement corresponds with the spiritual dynamic. And also we spoke about the temple vessels itself. And that's where Shaul is actually coming in, because he found a specific formula on one of the temple vessels that is important to what's gonna happen right now. So Shaul, you yourself, a Kohen is a priest, and the Kohanim, the priests from Aaron's line, can be traced up till today. And Shaul is one of those Kohanim. And if you can just explain to us a little bit more about your journey, Shaul, the Aliyah that you made, and also that you became more religious yourself. And I just want to add one more thing. Shaul is a mathematician and a scientist, and he has many patents in the health and cognition field. So we're working with somebody that understands the Bible, understands science. So Shaul, if you can share with us.
The motivation why I came to Israel was twofold. One, I wanted to be religious, to keep kosher, to keep Shabbat, that in Argentina was something very, very difficult to achieve. Aspect. The second aspect is that I got an intuition that there is a science behind the Torah that makes understandable whatever we see now as just like a tale for many people. It's a tale. In this process, I was invited to give a lecture in a Congress of Torah and Science in Bar-Ilan University in 1975, and I choose a subject, the Sea of Shlomo.
What is the Sea of Shlomo, or the Sea of Solomon? That is the bronze wash basin that rested on the 12 oxen that was used by the priests for the ritual purification. And there was, it looks like on surface level in the Bible, that there is a discrepancy in the measurements of this. Applying his scientific background and the study of the Talmud, Shaul discovered that there is no discrepancy whatsoever in the given biblical measurements, neither lack of geometrical knowledge. His discovery originated mainly from three observations. Firstly, that there are well-known English translations which are faulty, and the proper translation of all Hebrew words in biblical texts was key to solving the conundrum. Secondly, that the Talmud contains most of the explanations to arrive to the exact form and dimensions of the Sea of Solomon. Thirdly, that looking with a mathematical mind at the various explanations and approaches of the Jewish sages, that on surface level looked like they refuted one another, Shaul was able to understand that all the approaches were correct, just providing the answers from different points of view. So after solving this, you extrapolated a certain angle out of the formula of the Sea of Solomon.
Yes.
And then you applied it to another existing formula that has to do with the planetary axis and its inclination, and that there's some kind of it's decreasing all the time. What is that?
Well, the the planet has an axis of rotation.
Okay.
And this axis of rotation is decreasing all the time the angle.
Okay.
In relation to the orbit of the planet around the sun.
Shaul went on explaining that this inclination is manifested in the latitude of the tropical line Cancer in the northern hemisphere, which is continuously decreasing, moving south in about 1 meter per month. Adding to this angle of inclination of our planet, a fundamental angle found in the design of the Sea of Solomon, Shaul realized that this sum represents the latitude of a parallel geographical planetary line by which the timings for the entries and the exits of the people of Israel to and from the land of Israel can now be mathematically obtained.
And then I discovered that if I calculate the inclination of the planet for the year of destruction of the first temple,
yes,
I calculate where the line is,
yes,
and the line is crossing the Temple Mount.
Meaning you realize that there's a certain line together bringing in the wisdom of the way that the temple is built and the temple vessels, extrapolating something from that, applying it to a scientific line, you could then see that there was a line that fell during the temple destruction exactly
in the Temple Mount.
Was it on the Holy of Holies where the Dome of the Rock is today?
No, a little bit south.
A little bit south.
The 586 is a little bit south.
Okay, so what happened when it fell exactly on the Dome of the Rock?
At that time is the beginning of the 70 years of Yirmiyahu.
Ah, so remember that there was an exile before the destruction, where they started to take some of the people to Babylon.
The worst 70 years for Israel started when the line crosses the Holy of Holies. When they finish, precisely when the line leaves the city of David.
What we're saying is the 70 years of exile to Babylon, this specific line fell from the Holy of Holies up to the most southern point of the city of David. Firstly, we understand, therefore, that the ancient biblical Jerusalem, the true location, plays a massive part in this whole equation. But more than that, in layman's terms, what we're saying here is with this formula that Shaul has, there is a line that moves over Earth, and when it hits certain specific marks according to the biblical borders of Israel, things happen, and we can see a movement of the people of Israel towards the land of Israel, or outside, an immigration, an exile from the land of Israel. And this is where we would really like to understand it a little bit more, Shaul. So what you saw right now is it didn't only happen during this exile, but we can see a lot of the immigration, the entrances and the exits of the people of Israel into the land of Israel, even in the time of Jericho, when they had to cross the Jordan River.
Well, this was one of the tests of the formula.
Wow, okay.
I tested the formula and say, what will happen with the line at the time that Israel wanted to cross the Jordan River? I calculated the time that I have it, the line where it goes, Jericho.
Wow.
So the line goes in Jericho.
So with this formula, if you know where it moves, you can then apply the times. Or you can take the time and you can see where it falls.
Where is
here
the
in Israel.
Is the immigration or emigration of Israel.
Okay. So give us another one. Is there another specific one?
Another one very, very interesting is when the line goes out of Beit Shemesh in the southern border, the line in the year 167 before Common Era.
Mm. And what happened there?
Well, the Maccabeans. But it's not Rags Beit Shemesh, because this wasn't the border of one of the tribes.
Okay. So
it wasn't the border of the tribe.
According to the borders of the tribes. And this is very important. This whole formula only works when you go according to the biblical borders of Israel the way that God said the land of Israel is, and not according to any political demarcations that we have today. But we can see this also in modern day.
What happens is that because the line moves south and south all mm-hmm. the time, mm-hmm. and it's decreasing 1,000 years before now, and it will continue decreasing in many 1,000 years in the future.
Okay.
Now, the line moves south, south, south. There is a point mm-hmm. where for the first time ever, the line goes out from the biblical land of Israel, 1948.
Oh, okay. So for
and
the
that point is the first time that the line goes out. Uh-huh. All the time is inside the biblical land, uh-huh. and in this precise point goes out. On the west of the Jordan River, mm-hmm. the line is above the territory of Judah.
And it's still crossing all the time because the territory of Judah is very big.
And on the right side...
On the east side of the Jordan River.
On the east side, it was crossing all the time Reuben, till it goes out okay. for the first time.
Okay. So the moment when it started to hit this most southern border of the Arnon River, because that's the border, we had 1948 and the establishment of Israel. And then we had another, because now you have to understand that the Arnon River curves. And every time when it hits certain spots on this borderline, we can see massive immigration.
A process of immigration.
Of immigration to Israel. And I believe that the Russian immigration also,
also.
Can be traced on that.
Also.
But this is where it's getting very interesting. So we can see even in the modern times, as this line moves over the Arnon River at certain specific points, great things happen. And now in August, this year, just after Tisha B'Av, according to the calculations of Shaul, we can see that it's going to hit a few marks again in this month and moving into a two-year window period, and after that it will continue for another almost a 9 to 10 year period. So what can you tell us a little bit more about this line crossing right now, and what can we expect?
I want for people to make clear that the same formula applies from the beginning of history till now, the same formula. Mm-hmm. Before biblical times, mm-hmm. during biblical times, and in modern times. It doesn't affect the kind of time in we are. The formula is the same everywhere, and the results are the same.
But let's talk about this two-year period. You're speaking of that there is an expectation now for a massive immigration again to Israel because of this line crossing a very strong few points on the Arnon River.
Yeah.
Is that what I understand?
Yeah. It's something that comes out of the blue. It's the same thing that in the year 45, 46, mm-hmm. and all the Jews will come. We have mm-hmm. coming mm-hmm. after the killing in Europe. Mm-hmm. Nobody will think such a thing. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, things turn out and comes. Now the same. Even if doesn't look such a thing, mm-hmm. things will move. Mm-hmm. Not controlled by men, because all this process is not controlled by men. Mm-hmm. If you ask me what I suspect, but this is an opinion of Shaul Kullook, I don't know exactly how it will be. What it will be is an Aliyah. I can say, first of all, it will be a radical change in all the Middle East. The final result will be a much better economical situation of Israel.
Huh.
Much better.
Yes, okay.
And one result of it is that people will come.
There we go.
This is one.
Okay.
Second, that the mechanism, the process mm-hmm. by which the non-Jews will find out that the Torah is not a tale, is not a very interesting story, mm-hmm. not only for non-Jews, for the Jews it's a tale, will start to change, and the people will start to take seriously what the Torah is saying. Uh-huh. And this looks crazy, but this is what will happen.
So basically, in two things, it looks like the economy of Israel will be strengthened, and secondly, there will be a better consciousness and understanding of the nations, that the Torah is not just a tale. It is a godly inspired book.
And therefore, it will be really a good thing to come to Israel.
And that will actually...
The other way around, it will be a very, very good thing.
To bring immigration. Guys, this is in short what's happening.
This is very short. Well, there are many details, but this is...
It's been very difficult for me to get Shaul to keep it really short, because I want to just get the nucleus here. If all these things are starting to happen, if we will start seeing this pattern manifesting, then we will go really into more depth. What we're basically saying is, if you look at Psalms 19, it speaks how the sun and the moon and the stars and everything plays part. All the heavenly bodies play their role and their part in God's governance in the world. But not just that, how the exits and the entrances of the people of Israel into the land of Israel, and that according to the biblical borders that God said, this is by which I'm working. So Shaul, we're seeing that the whole creation is working together in all of this.
In the creation is working as a witness in heavens and earth, and that the word of Hashem is true and is fulfilling what He promised to Abraham, Yitzchak and Yaakov. Because the inclination of the planet to be the way it is, the value and the rhythm of change got to be exactly like it is. A specific balance of forces in the solar system. And how you combine the solar system, the moon, and the planets and the disks, etc., that there should be this inclination. Heavens is a witness.
And that's what we see in Deuteronomy, right? What is written there?
It's written that I put heaven and earth as a witnesses that they will choose Torah.
For so long, we've been trying to put this in on paper. What we discuss here today is a small little line of a massive world of what Shaul has been looking into. So let's follow this together and see how it plays out. We're talking about an initial two-year window period where we expect a lot of changes to happen, but also a 10-year window period in which a few things will play itself out. Shaul, thank you so much for joining. We will see you guys soon, hopefully explaining more about this. Shalom from Jerusalem.
Absolutely.